All right, we are back with more virtual interviews. I'm really excited to have Adam with me. Adam, thanks for joining me.
Thank you very much.
It's awesome to have you here. So maybe we start out with talking about what you're talking about this year at the conference and kind of how you decided on that topic and how it came about. Because I know you're in a collaboration with another individual too.
Yes, absolutely. So Jana and I were talking over IM the other day, saying, you know, we've had some really interesting lessons learned with teams moving from waterfall to agile and needing to figure out where the test strategy belongs. They're so used to having this large monolith document and then the time to create that document.
Right.
So now we have 2-week releases, maybe even everyday releases. So what are the core components that a tester needs to be aware of to understand how to create a test strategy in these brand new environments?
Yeah. That's awesome.
Yeah, it's cool.
So what are some of the, so for the folks out there that are like, hey, that's my problem, but I don't get to go to your session, what are some cool tips or techniques you're gonna talk about on that?
Yeah, so part of it is just to remember that it's a conversation. So truly, and I believe that the role of QA is to provide, and the role of testers is to provide information.
Yeah.
Right, so that really is what we're doing by doing our testing, our automation, we're providing information on risk.
Yep.
And a test strategy is really your plan on how you're going to provide that information.
Yep.
And so think about it that way. So instead of thinking about it, you know, I must create this document with all these various, you know, different types of sections, think about how am I going to communicate my plan to identify risk. So if you think about it from that standpoint, it really changes it. It changes it from having to focus on a document to, you know, more of a, I can be now more a bit more creative on this.
Absolutely. And I love how you phrase that. It's a conversation, right?
Absolutely a conversation.
So use that as the tool like you would to have a conversation, right? And make
Absolutely.
It a dialogue on that in that information, which I love. Now, there may be folks out there saying, hey, I want to talk, or I have an idea of something that I think people would want to hear about, right?
Sure.
Because everyone every day, just like that topic, when you and Jana were IMing, sometimes go, hey, there's this thing that I've been dealing with and maybe other people are too, and they'd want to hear about my approach to it, or you know, how to solve this challenge, or I want to talk to people and get feedback on it. You know, how do people go about that and sit in your chair and get to talk to other people about their ideas?
Yeah, so one of the best ways to do it is to think about the personal experiences that you've had where it may be pain points. I pull on my failures a lot. I failed a lot as a tester, right?
Yeah.
Because I think it gives us an understanding on how to approach our work a bit differently.
Yeah.
So take those personal experiences. One of the cool things you can do is start out with a blog article.
Yeah.
There's so many various companies. I mean, TechWell is a good one to where you can just propose.
They love articles.
Yeah, they love articles.
Love
and so
articles.
It's a good way to approach and see if you get good feedback and if it's something that is receptive. And from there, you can actually start driving that into more of a longer presentation.
Right.
Attend the conferences is great. And oftentimes one of the things I like to do is, you know, everyone here is so welcoming.
Yes.
So just go up to one of the talk speakers and say, hey, I have something and I'd like to talk to you about it. Do you have any ideas on how I could turn this into a talk or a presentation?
Yeah.
That's how I did it when I first started out.
Yeah.
And there were so many people that were like, yeah, we would love to sit with you and we can help you shape this.
Yeah. No, I think that's a great point too is, for those of you watching virtually, obviously you don't get to be here in person, but one of the big things that happens behind the scenes is exactly what you talked about. It's the value of the knowledge share, right?
Absolutely.
Imagine, I said it last night when they brought all the speakers to a dinner and they put them in the same room, and it's like having all these people with all these different areas of expertise around testing in the same space at the same time.
Yeah.
Right?
It's so wonderful.
even to virtually find all those people and get to talk to them would be near impossible if you didn't get that opportunity, right?
Exactly.
Of being at this event and they're all there. You can have those conversations from performance testing to security to AI to DevOps to automation, like anything you want. It's all there.
Absolutely.
And
it's wonderful.
Yeah, you get to just share all that knowledge and that information. So it's a good reason to, like you said, propose something so you can come to these, you know, have that experience, get to meet and talk to all of the folks. And I think it is one of the best parts of these or that I enjoy or take away is even outside of the sessions, having the dialogues and the discussions with the people.
Yeah, and so much of the magic actually happens outside of the sessions. You know, and I've been coming to the STAR conferences since like the early 2000s.
Yeah.
So being
able to... Yeah, me too. Are we getting old?
Maybe, no, we're getting well aged, like a fine wine.
Oh, good.
Like a fine
okay,
wine.
Good.
Yes.
Good. I like that.
Yes.
I like that approach better.
And everyone's been so wonderful, right? I mean, you learn so much just from having experiences and talking with the folks.
You do. And it's fun to see it evolve. And different years have different feels. So, like, each conference that you come to, because they're different people,
they
right?
are.
There's different people that add to the community and the culture of the event and
absolutely.
All of that. So it's kind of fun.
Yeah, absolutely.
One of the other things that I had an interview earlier today, and we talked about attracting and retaining talent. Lots of people out there mm-hmm. hire people. You look mm-hmm. for lots of people.
Absolutely.
And we know that more and more of our world is driven by technology, so we need more and more people in
absolutely.
That space. You know, and you and I both having what I call tiny humans, or our tiny human people. How do you, any suggestions to encourage people that have children to get them into seeing if they're interested in technology and seeing if they're interested in testing and all of the things that we do?
Yeah, so there's a couple of good things that I like. So there's this workflow type language, and I believe it's called Swift. Don't
yep.
quote me on it, but yeah, so Swift,
yep.
Where essentially it teaches kids to understand logic.
Yeah.
Because that's, to me, is the most important thing, is to have your kids, don't worry about the coding,
yeah.
don't worry about the languages,
yep.
have them understand what happens, if this happens, then this happens.
Yep.
You can do it with robotics. I know my daughter has the Sphero toy,
oh,
where she's able to like move things over. So, you know, let it go forward for a little bit, let it go left. And there's another one we like, which is called Tinker, where she gets to actually help Barbie build a cake by selecting just some various flows.
Yeah.
And so for them, they don't think that they're learning programming, and it's not, let's sit down and learn programming.
Right.
It's more, hey, I get to move these things over and these things happen. So it's this cause and effect.
Yeah.
And it gets them naturally curious.
Right.
And as my daughter's gotten older, she's realized, speaking of little ones, as my daughter's gotten older, she's realized that she can make her own Minecraft characters.
Yeah.
By doing a lot of this stuff. So she's able to relate it to the video games, which they so love now. So,
right, exactly.
So I would say just building on that natural curiosity is the biggest thing. Don't force it.
No.
And I know some parents are, you know, really against computer time.
Yeah.
But what we typically will do is we'll set just a certain period of time and say 30 minutes.
Yep.
You get your own kind of free play.
Yeah.
And then for 30 minutes, I'm going to sit with you, and we're going to work on some things together.
Yeah.
So it kind of also builds that, you know, that relationship together of doing some things together. And then we go do some physical activities.
Right.
So, you know.
And mix it up.
And
like, because I know you guys run, right?
Yep. Yes, we run. Yeah, we do running together. And typically what we find is kids around like that 6 to 8, they can only really absorb about 10 minutes worth of actual learning about that at a time. So you break it up, like you do some fun things. So I would just say, you know, do what you can to encourage it to naturally happen and to build that curiosity.
Yeah, because then it, like you said, you're teaching them the logic, you're teaching them the patterns, the thought behind it, the cause and effect. And those are just good skills.
Absolutely.
Right? I mean, those are things you want them to have anyways. And so giving them those tools where they understand that early and have that critical thinking, you know, and problem solving, I think is so important.
It's very important.
Yeah, and it's gotten more, I think, more and more important as, you know, all of us, if we think about, if we have, I was just saying the other day, you used to have discussions and you couldn't Google things to get the answer.
Yes.
So you would like have more of a discussion because no one could be like, hey, this is what it is, right?
Yep.
Or this is the answer. And now we do that, so things just come, like we get answers quicker,
yes.
right? Versus having to trial and error a lot of things. So
yes.
having those experiences of trial and error versus just being able to Google, I think is such a good thing for people.
Yeah, and I think that it also builds some good communication skills, because one of the things that we see, especially for those trying to hire in new testers you know, into the market, is, you know, we see a lack of building communication skills in the colleges.
Yes.
Where they teach some presenting skills, but they don't actually teach how to solicit information from someone, you know, by active listening, you know, by having that conversation. So, you know, we do see a weakness in testers, where now we're seeing more technical testers, but we're seeing, you know, testers and those in QA that need a little bit more help on the QA, on the communication side.
Right.
So, you know, if you can teach your kids, and even, you know, for those with older, or if you're in college or hiring, you know, Gen Zers or millennials, you know, really work to help them understand how to carry on a communication, because I think so many of them are used to just, you know, if I want to find something, I'm just going to look at my phone.
Right.
But instead, now I need to get, you know, Bob over there
right.
to tell me what I need to understand so I can understand the risk.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, and it is. It's that dialogue and that conversation again. Back to it's information and conversation is really important.
Absolutely.
Because you get a lot more out of that. And I talk a lot, too, about, you know, you need to have that because things get so complicated. Like the technologies we're working on are very
yes.
complex. People don't attach the same meaning to something. So we think, okay, we're going to solve this problem. Well, that same problem, if you don't talk to people, may look different.
Yes.
So
and you may wind up reinventing the wheel as well if you don't talk about it.
Yeah, exactly.
Yes.
And just soliciting, like you said, information, feedback, and ideas and refining that communication. Anything you guys do in particular at Anthem with training inside once you get people where they haven't done some of their, they have those skill gaps?
Sure. Like, yeah. So a lot of it is just teaching folks on, you know, the biggest thing is active listening. Right, that is one of the biggest skills that we find that we need to train folks on is, you know, when you are having a conversation with someone, make sure that you're listening to the point to where you ask them questions to clarify.
Absolutely.
And that clarification, and one of the big things that they teach them is assume that you're misunderstanding.
Yes.
Right, and then ask enough questions to where you can clarify that misunderstanding.
Yes.
So that's really the big thing that we kind of teach them on is, you know, don't just say, yeah, okay, I got it. Say, hey,
right.
I just want to make sure that I truly understand. Let's
right.
let's whiteboard it. Let's walk through.
Yeah.
Let's, you know, try to dig into it and explore it a little
and,
bit.
And make sure we all have the same meaning of what's going to happen.
Exactly right.
Because, yeah, it's the funniest thing. The other day at the office, we were having a conversation with a couple of our technical folks, and there was five of us in the room, and we asked the folks that were actually going to go do the work, we said, okay, do we all understand what we're going to do? And they're like, yep. And I go, okay, just so we're clear, can you just tell me what we're going to do
awesome.
When you leave?
Yeah.
You know, let's just, so I'm clear, like, just tell me what you're going to do when you leave this room. And they all went, and I went, uh-oh,
yeah.
blank stares.
Yeah,
like,
exactly.
we need to,
yeah.
this is the exactly what you said, right? Like,
yeah.
And then they would have sat at their desks and went, blank stare at the computer, right?
Yeah.
So it's good to know that before people struggle through it and have those conversations,
Absolutely.
Engage them, whiteboard, make sure everyone's on the same page.
Absolutely.
So it always goes too fast. We
it
are
does.
Out of time. We will be back with another virtual interview, so stay tuned for our next one coming up.
Thanks everyone.
Thanks,
you.
Adam.